So this is Instagram, huh? There's a lot of sluts on here. It worked! Listen to me, I'm you from the future. I came back in time to tell you, do not watch Terminator Dark Fate. It's really shit. I figured that already. You don't have to be from the future to know how this film is going to turn out. Bit of a wasted trip then. Yeah, is that all? Pretty much. Learn Chinese. You'll understand soon enough. What? I have to get back to the rice fields. Well, fuck. It's another sequel soft reboot thing of a classic movie franchise that has come straight off the Hollywood factory floor for us to slurp down. Did we need another Terminator film? Apparently the money men in suits think so. See, Linda Hamilton and Arnold Schwarzenegger, as you've never seen them before, fossilized and fucking tired. Marvel at this lazy patchwork of ideas crammed into a computer-generated movie that is utterly devoid of creativity. Produced by James Cameron, which means bugger all. Terminator Dark Fate can now join Predator, Alien, and Jurassic Park in soft reboot hell because Paramount Pictures and our Chinese overlords at Tencent wanted to make bank off another established franchise. Let's have a little retrospective of said franchise to see how it all started and where it all went downhill. The Terminator is quintessentially 80s. It has purple lasers and frizzy hairdos. It was made by the king of the world himself, James Cameron. The film is about a time-traveling Terminator, which is a cyborg assassin robot thing, played by Arnold Schwarzenegger, whose patented brand of acting actually fits an autistic killer robot. He's on a mission to kill clumsy waitress Sarah Connor, but she's no ordinary waitress. Her prophetic ovaries will birth future resistance leader John Connor, who will help take back the planet from the machines. In the future, a powerful artificial intelligence called Skynet has nearly wiped out humanity and will make Los Angeles look like this 10 years from now. That's Los Angeles in 10 years? Wow, James Cameron, you sure missed the mark. That's Los Angeles now. Skynet wants to stop John Connor's meddling, so it sends an Austrian cyborg back in time to kill his mother. In retaliation, future John Connor creates a time paradox by sending his father, Kyle Reese, back in time to act as both protector and sperm donor for Sarah. Straightforward plot, really. The Terminator murders everything that stands in its way in an interesting mix of sci-fi and slasher horror. The movie also throws in all that wibbly-wobbly, timey-wimey time travel crap, with things like causality and fatalism that would later get very muddled by the sequels. The film was very low budget, but still tried to tell an epic story about time travel and a future machine war. Some of the practical effects look dated, yet the actual Terminator design was simple but effective. It's just a spooky skeleton made of metal, but iconic nonetheless. After a massive body count is accumulated, Kyle and Sarah take on the Terminator head-to-head, which results in Sarah's baby daddy getting schwacked. Luckily, our plucky heroine is able to defeat Mr. Cyberbones, and at the end is left alone to face single motherhood and the impending apocalypse. I love a happy ending. Terminator 2, Judgment Day. What a classic movie. James Cameron took all the elements from Terminator 1 and supercharged them. More action, more characterization, and better special effects. Some fans consider the sequel better than the original, and I can see why. Terminator 2 sees John Connor as a squeaky reprobate with daddy issues, who's being hunted by a liquid metal man who can shapeshift into a constipated police officer. The film changes up the character dynamics quite a bit. Arnold plays a reprogrammed good Terminator, sent back in time to protect John, but he also develops a conscience and becomes slightly paternal. Sarah Connor becomes a self-actualized action hero who is also trying to defy the future. The three of them work together to change the future by destroying the technology that would make Skynet become self-aware and get all pissy at humans. Simple plot about fighting your destiny with killer robots, but also wholesome family values, and this mix strangely worked. The film had nice little visual details and some great action sequences. A classic. It's just a really good movie. Terminator 3 Rise of the Machines was a farce. John Connor is a sniveling bitch boy. Sarah Connor is dead from leukemia. Arnold Schwarzenegger is a snarky asshat Terminator. And the evil Terminator is a lady bot with the ability to inflate her tits at will. What a joke! But at least Earth got nuked because Judgment Day is inevitable. I saw Terminator Salvation.
Oh, good for you! And how was it?
Very disappointing. I appreciate that it did something different. No time travel guff, and it was set in the post-apocalyptic future that the other films had only alluded to. The problem was everything else. The plot was lackluster, and the acting was terrible. John Connor is portrayed poorly by Christian Bale, who barks his lines and permanently scowls. Sam Worthington plays a Terminator who is a tin man with a heart and wants to be human. Ugh, can't blame him, as the iconic Terminators in this are stupidly ineffective and just throw people around. The only thing that stood out was CGI Uncanny Valley Arnold, but he quickly gets his skin melted off because that de-aging stuff is expensive. Ultimately, Salvation added nothing to the franchise. There was also a passable TV series where Sarah Connor is played by Cersei Lannister. In the series, Sarah and her son, John, go forward in time to when the series aired to stay relevant, where they have misadventures with Terminators. In this timeline, John Connor not only sends people back in time to fuck his mum, but also sends an Asian sex bot for his teenage self. Priorities. Unlucky for him, he sent Summer Glau, and as everyone knows, any TV show she stars in inevitably gets cancelled, which is exactly what happened to this one after two seasons. Then we had the huge skid mark on the franchise that is Terminator We Don't Know How to Spell Genesis. The mother of dragons and eyebrow actor extraordinaire Emilia Clarke is now Sarah Connor in an alternative timeline that takes plot points from Terminator 1 and 2 and rehashes them into a convoluted chimera that ends up all over the place. The acting is bad, the plot is bad, and the whole thing just felt like a soulless cash grab. John Connor gets turned into an evil Terminator hybrid thing because fuck you. Skynet is now a killer phone app. Ooh, contemporary. Black Mirror, eat your heart out. Arnold is a stoic comic relief cyborg that just ruins the tone. In fact, throughout the film, there are out-of-place comedic moments thrown in just for the hell of it. Kyle Reese is played badly by Jai Courtney, and he doesn't die in this timeline. In Genesis, the timeline changes a lot as the trio of caricatures jump from past to present trying to thwart Skynet because hopefully this time defeating Skynet will actually stick. However, because of all the time travel, the franchise's continuity is a tangled mess and the plot has more holes than a triple-cunted hooker. With each new addition to the franchise, the Terminator legacy as a whole gets dulled and becomes that bit more played out. We get new Terminators with new gimmicks, reused plot points from previous films, and catchphrase references.
I'll be back. I'll be back. I'm back.
I'll be back.
I'll be back.
Terminator Dark Fate is just more of the same, so we can add this sequel to the shit heap. The movie starts with a big callback by showing you Sarah Connor's psychological evaluation from Terminator 2, thus reminding you of what the last good Terminator film was. We then cut to 1998, with computerized, de-aged Linda Hamilton and de-aged Edward Furlong briefly reprising his role as John Connor. But Skynet has apparently sent other Terminators throughout time as contingencies, and so a de-aged Arnold kills Furlong before his cholesterol levels do. Hold on. This is a massive slap in the face. John Connor, the post-apocalyptic messiah, the savior of humanity, who will free us from the evil machine's tyranny, whom Skynet has always tried to assassinate because he's so bloody important, gets killed off because he doesn't actually matter. He's inconsequential, which also means all the other Terminator films are inconsequential. All those battles and triumphs were for nothing. This film retroactively ruins the previous films. Everything gets retconned, and this is within the first 5 minutes. Then things go from bad to Mexican, as we jump 22 years to Guatemala. It is here Mackenzie Davis teleports in as androgynous augmented human Grace, who looks oddly like Dylan Roof, the Charleston shooter. Not the best design, aesthetically. Moving on, she, him, ze, zer, it, whatever, is an enhanced human with cybernetics, because everything has to be souped up and overcharged in these sequels. Her mission is to find and protect Danny Ramos, played terribly by Natalia Reyes, who will be the new future resistance leader. With John being irrelevant, the new savior of mankind that has taken his place is this Mexican woman. She's the important one now. Not helping the stereotype of Mexicans stealing jobs, are you, Hollywood? Shame on you, Hollywood. Shame. Hopefully, this new girl will be a suitable replacement for John and have great on-screen charisma. And hopefully, she can actually act.
I'm gonna stand and fight!
Oh dear. As with any Terminator film, you've got to have your antagonist Terminator to play cat and mouse with the cast. The new gimmicky Terminator is Gabriel Luna, playing the Rev 9, who is part robot and part black goo of unoriginality. Essentially, the Rev 9 is a Terminator that is covered in nanites and is like the T-1000 from Terminator 2. But the two machines can split apart and act autonomously. Also, it makes him basically indestructible, and at best all the characters can do is slow him down a bit. I've noticed this trend in movies of late. It's not enough to have the original movie monster we all love. It has to be a weird hybrid Frankenstein's monster with an increased cool factor. It's overdone, and stylistically it's making all these reboots very repetitive. Anyway, this menacing Mexican goes to Danny's home and steals her father's likeness because he has shape-shifting abilities, like all the other bad Terminators from the previous films. The Rev 9 goes to Danny's place of work to give her an ass-kicking, but Little Miss Cyborg is there to beat him like a ginger stepchild. We now get our first taste of over-the-top computer-generated action. It's awful. The combat doesn't feel impactful, and it's very floaty. The choreography leaves much to be desired, and what a weird move. Why does that look so familiar? Ah, it's the old Emperor Palpatine flying spinning move. After blasting computer-generated nonsense at us, Grace, Danny, and her expendable meatbag brother run away and steal a vehicle. The Rev 9 is a hard fucker to kill, and he pursues the hapless humans. Then there is a chase sequence with a truck and a Terminator, just like in The Terminator. Terminator 2, Terminator 3, Terminator Salvation, Terminator Genesis. So far, it's looking like every other Terminator film. Feels like the whole movie is just one big callback. Speaking of which, Linda Hamilton is back as Sarah Connor, armed with an automatic shotgun and a hip replacement. Conveniently for Danny and Grace, Sarah was in the neighborhood and quickly dispatches both forms of the Rev 9 to show all you youngsters that this coffin dodger's still got it. Linda also spouts contractually obligated callback lines.
I'll be back.
That delivery was worth the price of admission. As much as the marketing for this film hyped up the return of Linda as Sarah Connor, she doesn't really bring much energy to the role. She spends most of the film grimacing and swearing her tits off. Linda looks tired in every scene, and a lot of her performance seems phoned in, and rightly so because she's elderly. If anything, Sarah Connor has been given the Luke Skywalker treatment, a legendary hero reduced to a surly curmudgeon. After Grace has a little lie down from fighting too much, and after she's taken a crap load of drugs, Sarah catches up with the whippersnappers, so the movie can take a big steaming exposition dump for those who've never seen a Terminator film in their life, as Sarah and Grace swap backstories in a motel room. But the more they try to explain, the more convoluted the plot gets. In the grim, dark, alternative future they're talking about, Skynet no longer exists, but has been replaced by another AI called Legion, which serves the exact same purpose as Skynet. So what's the point? If anything, Skynet has just rebranded itself to sound more ominous. Anyway, it sent back a Rev-9 to kill Danny and change the timeline, which gets confusing because Sarah explains that she's saved billions of lives by stopping Skynet in Terminator 2. But an alternative future where those billions die happens anyway, so all her efforts were for nothing. It gets further confusing because Sarah has been hunting Terminators from a timeline that no longer exists, because Skynet was destroyed through her actions in Terminator 2, and she kills these displaced Terminators out of a sense of revenge for John's death. But the whole point of John was that if he died, the timelines change irrevocably. If John dies, he can't send Kyle Reese back in time, which means John Connor never exists in the first place, and Sarah Connor never fulfills her destiny and stays a waitress with no involvement with Skynet or the future war. But the time paradox never gets addressed, it's just hand-waved. Which means the time travel has no consequence, it's all superfluous. But apparently not, because if Danny dies, then humanity is doomed. But if Judgment Day is inevitable, and an evil AI takes over regardless of who gets killed, then does it really matter if Danny gets assassinated? Did anything Sarah did even matter? It diminishes the stakes of everything. Whatever. I suppose you're not meant to think too hard about it. Ah, fuck it. I'm checking out. I'll turn my brain off then. Yeah. Sarah explains that she's been getting anonymous texts giving her locations of Terminators to kill, and that their best hope of survival is to find the source. Grace tracks the location of the source on Sarah's phone to somewhere in Texas, but Grace also has the mysterious location tattooed on her, memento style. Okay. So Granny Connor, Dora the Explorer, and the LGBT 1000 do a spot of border hopping. They travel across the border, where they bitch at each other and show off their complete lack of chemistry. After traveling like illegal immigrants, they finally reach the promised land of America. And truly, it is the land of freedom and opportunity. Until Border Patrol detains their asses. Adios, burritos! With Grace injured from a drone attack set up by the Rev-9, and Sarah just sitting about, Danny is left vulnerable since the Rev-9 has tracked her dumbass down again. Not to worry though, as Grace wakes up, Kung Fu fights everyone with a pulse, frees Danny and a load of illegals, while Border Patrol guards get skewered because fuck helping them, the filmmakers clearly aren't fond of America's immigration policies, and by God they're gonna let you know about it. The gang escape off to Texas to find their inside man. Who could it be? Hey, what up, Mash Schwarzenegger? Arnold is back as the T-800, but not the one from the previous films. He's the one who popped a cap in Little Johnny Connor. But he felt bad and quickly developed a conscience all by himself. And then he got married and started calling himself Carl. Carl, the friendly Terminator, everyone. Ugh. Now the classic Terminator is domesticated and sells drapes, which just outright neuters him and takes away the intimidation factor. He's the one who's been telling Sarah where to hunt the displaced Terminators because he feels bad for killing John, like it would give her some sort of closure. Carl knew about the Rev-9 coming from an alternative timeline because he felt it. What? That is some lazy writing. Might as well say Carl the Terminator is a magical time-traveling wizard. I swear, a monkey wrote this script with its penis. Speaking of writing, the dialogue is woeful, and the writers try to sneak in snarky quips, but all the humor falls flat on its stupid face.
So you're Carl.
That's what everyone calls me, yes.
I'm never gonna fucking call you Carl.
After hearing the gang's story, Arnold agrees to help Danny, because he has a soft spot for Mexicans. The team devise a plan to kill the Rev-9, which is basically use Danny as bait to lure him out and then EMP the fucker. Danny gets some quick training in the form of shooting stationary objects, and the gang feels that's enough for her to take on a fast-moving, shape-shifting killing machine that can split in two. Despite her being put on a pedestal, she's the weakest of the characters. Everyone just assumes she's amazing and strong, worthy of leading humanity. But for most of the film, she's pretty useless and relies on everyone else to get shit done. As much as the marketing is all about the female empowerment, it's actually very shallow in the film, and Arnold, a penis-carrying man, actually saves the day and steals all the glory anyway. The third act is mostly computer-generated, as the Rev-9 pursues the team in over-the-top action sequences. The gang manage to steal a jet with no reprisals from the military, and they stand off against the Rev-9 in what looks like a massive tech demo for Adobe After Effects. After we get our money's worth of explosions, our team of hapless fuckers conveniently crash at a dam that has enough space for a CGI fight sequence where everyone jumps around like a video game character and tussles with each other like rabid squirrels on meth. So, how do they beat this Terminator that is nigh indestructible? If you've seen Terminator 3, it's established that Terminators have highly explosive power cores inside them, and Grace just happens to have one of these doohickeys stuffed in her guts too. So, to defeat the Rev-9, they plan to rip out Grace's core and fuck his shit up. You could just use Carl's, but whatever, Grace needs to make a noble sacrifice. Carl is actually the one who defeats the Rev-9 anyway. Danny's only contribution is doing the home surgery on Grace, and then Carl just holds the Rev-9 in place until he goes kaboom. The final fight is basically the end of Terminator 3. Shit on a chandelier! Almost shot for shot. I was incredulous. How lazy can you be that you just copy straight from Terminator 3? There comes a point when it stops being homage and just turns into lazily reusing set pieces because the creators don't have a single original thought or concept in their heads. And Arnold sacrificing himself at the end is something we've seen in the previous films too. Dark Fate has to be one of the laziest reboots I've ever seen. At the end, Danny looks into a playground like a sex offender to visually invoke nostalgia for Terminator 2, where she spots a young Grace who has yet to become a jaded super soldier, and then she fucks off with Sarah Connor into the sunset. The end. Until the next unnecessary sequel. Terminator Dark Fate is very derivative. It follows the same plot structure as every other Terminator film. Terminator goes back in time to kill important person, another person goes back in time to protect them, hijinks ensue, big climatic battle with bad Terminator, roll credits. The series is in a perpetual time loop because of its premise. Judgment Day happens and robots take over, but Judgment Day is constantly delayed or rejigged in order to prolong the franchise. It makes everything very stale. How many times can you send a robot back in time to have adventures with the Connors and still keep it fresh? Get a computer with some script writing algorithm, take plot points and scenes from Terminator 2, and randomize the character's attributes. Make this one old, this one young, change sex, and hey presto, you have a brand new Terminator film. One of the key narrative elements of the films, time travel, is also a detriment. I've seen it in many modern movies. Time travel is used as a lazy way to fix things. It's okay if you write yourself into a corner, you can just add time travel to unfuck yourself. Need to reboot a new Star Trek franchise? Put in some time travel to bring back the old actors and create a new timeline where you can do whatever you like. And as for the X-Men franchise, time travel has fucked it six ways to Sunday and left a confusing, sticky mess on the curtains. I can't keep up with these timelines. What's canon? What's not? Who cares? Just buy tickets. Consume! Another trend I'm seeing of late is bringing back aged actors to reprise their old roles so that people will watch a shitty reboot. Now, I have nothing against these actors, but I believe you should let them age gracefully. Let them be remembered for when they did the role in their prime. Don't drag them out for a half-assed performance just because of nostalgia baiting. They're not going to be able to deliver the same youthful, energetic performance that they're remembered for. And studios always bring in newer, younger talent to prop them up anyway, for fear that younger audiences will be put off by 2 hours of geriatric action heroes. In the case of Dark Fate, I think Paramount Pictures needed a hook to get people to see this dreck, because it has nothing new going for it. Seen it all before, but Paramount and Tencent want to make a quick buck off the Terminator brand. It's not working though. This film is a massive flop. Is it any surprise? This film is a financial disaster? It's soulless, and the only thing they could do to get bums on theater seats was bring in old actors and market the thing with overdone identity politics. Not only that, but Dark Fate repeats the same mistakes as all the other crap sequels. Bloated time travel plots, over-reliance on computer-generated effects, a complete lack of characterization, callbacks and references galore, and obnoxious quipping. The only good thing I got from all this was a chance to re-watch the originals. They still hold up as well-crafted, self-contained movies. Watch those instead. Also, don't give money to Tencent or China. I miss the old days. Look, I'm picking rice. See? Not dissenting. Jesus. Oh, be a dear and like and subscribe. Wait, who the fuck am I even talking to? Ha 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 ha!